Thank you, Stefano, for the introduction and also for the invitation. Thanks also, Jean-Christophe, for the invitation. What I'm going to talk about is on non-conventional ergodic averages, and this is work done partly with Rio Moore, who is my PhD student, and also some work where before another PhD student I had was David Duncan, but also going to be mentioned there. Okay, so let's introduce the problem first. This has to do with the Erdős-Türen conjecture, which is from 1936, which is to say that if you have a sequence of integers such that the sum of the reciprocal is infinite, then this set must contain arbitrary long arithmetic progressions. So this conjecture is still open. So for the graduate student who might be interested in working on it, it's still open, okay? Now, I want just to talk about some of the results in this direction and also what was the motivations and the work by the joined with a PhD student on that. So first, try to understand conjecture is that sometimes these conjectures are made and they are necessary and sufficient conditions. But in this case, the fact that the sum of the reciprocal is infinite is just a sufficient condition in terms of these conjectures. If you look, for instance, at the example which is there, when you take the sequence 110, 11, 100, 101, 102, 1000, you see when you go to the powers of 10, they increase the size of the arithmetic progressions. Then you get a series which is summable, which is summable. And therefore, you have arithmetic progressions, but no, the sum of the reciprocal is finite. So this is just a sufficient condition. But it attracted a lot of interest. So just for the convenience of notation, I'm going to use n in bracket like this to denote a set of integers from 1 to capital N. Okay, so definition of a set, a subset of natural number with positive upper density. If you take the cardinality of A intersection of the segment 1 to N, and you divide by N, you take a limb sup of this ratio, then you get something which is bounded below by a constant which is alpha, which is strictly positive. So one important partial result on this conjecture was this famous similarity theorem, which is to say that if you take a set of positive upper density, the set of positive upper density, it's not too difficult to show that if you have a set of positive upper density, then the sum of the reciprocal of the integers which belongs to this set is infinite. It's a small exercise, not difficult to prove. So in some ways, if you take a condition saying that a set has positive upper density, then you have automatically the assumption of the Erdős-Türen conjecture to be fulfilled. Now, this theorem was proved by Smeridi basically by hand. It was a tour de force to try to get it just for the case of arbitrary progression of length 3, then after that, for arbitrary progression of length k. Now, if you look at the set of prime numbers, the set of prime numbers also satisfies the Erdős-Türen assumptions, in a sense that I even went to, for the talk, and just for you, Stefano, went and looked to, how far can I go back? I went back to 1737, you see? So that you know that I came prepared and doing that seriously, okay? So you can even find a lower bound for that, the sum of reciprocal. It's basically of the order of log n plus 1 minus log pi square over 6, okay? Don't ask me to prove that. I'm not going to give you a proof of that now, but it's not by the fact that this is true. And this tells you that, the sum of the reciprocal also, the sum is infinite. Now, why am I mentioning that? It's because we know that a set of prime numbers contain arbitrary long arithmetic progressions. This is a result done by Green and Tao. But beyond these two, which is basically the set of positive upper density and the set of prime numbers, the Erdős-Türen conjecture is still open. Okay. Now, in 1977, Fürstenberg proved by using given another proof of Smerdy theorems by using ergodic theory. Okay, so he showed that in fact, if I take any measure probability measure frame system and a set E with positive measure, then this lim F is strictly positive. And the positivity of this lim F is directly connected to the fact that for an appropriate dynamical system, then if you take your sequence, you can embed it into this dynamical system and show that, in fact, the fact that it has positive upper density guarantees the existence of an invariant measure, which makes this system basically, you know, a measure-preserving system. Okay? So if you want, I'll give you a little bit more detail a bit later about it, how you make the connection between this set of integers and the dynamical system. Is there a question there? Is there a question? Okay. So that's what you have. And so that's provided a quite now famous proof of this Smerdy theorem by using ergodic theory. Yes. So you see what you are doing here is that you are taking the lim F, okay, of one over n, the sum from n equal zero, I think I use zero to n minus one, and then you have nu of the intersection from I equals zero to k minus one, and then you have S minus I n of E, right? Okay. So if you do that, if you integrate that, what you have is 1 over n, the integral of a sum from n equals 0 to n minus 1. And then what you have here is the product from I equals 0 to k minus 1 of a kinetic function of E that you apply to Sin. That's what you integrate with respect to a measure nu. So this quantity here, when you move the integral there, this is equal to 1 over n, the sum from n equals 0 to n minus 1 of the integral of the product from I equals 0 to k minus 1 of a characteristic function of E applied to Sin d nu. This term here is exactly equal to this one. Agree? Yes? So the difference with think, for instance, if you take the case k equal 3, what you have here is you have a quadratic function of E that you take at S n of E. The averages of that are the classical ergodic averages, but you multiply this function by the quadratic function of E that you apply at S to n E. S n of X and S X. Is it okay? And that's what you integrate with respect to nu. And that's what gives you this. Because the product of the characteristic functions, the integral of the product of the characteristic functions is the same as the integral of as a measure of the intersection of the two sets. Yes? Okay. So that's what you have here. Okay, so then if you want to, you see S. What you have here in terms of the action, you have the action of S and S square, right? But S and S square, in fact, are commuting transformations. So the generalization that came later on of this result by Fürstenberg and Castelson was to use S1 and S2, where S1 and S2 are just commuting transformations. So, the question is can you understand a bit better this structure of this set of positive upper density? Okay, which creates all these arithmetic progressions and all that. Now, if you follow carefully the proof, the connection between this set of positive upper density that I said is a dynamical system, and this dynamical system, the fact that you have a positive upper density guarantees the existence of an invariant measure. And this invariant measure is related directly to the constant alpha that you have here. So there's another also reason why I'm looking at that is there's another proof of Fürstenberg, which is also to prove that we have infinitely many primes. This is a proof which is dated from 1955. And again, the basis of that is also is a topological proof, which is using also the set of arithmetic progressions. You take on Z, the collection of all the arithmetic progressions. This arithmetic projection constitutes a basis. And with this basis, you can express prove by contradiction that we cannot have no finitely many primes. So how can you do get some information? One way is to put a weight in front of that, put a Cn in front of this, and see if, no, by any chance, what are the conditions on Cn so that will guarantee that this is going to be strictly positive. So before getting a deterministic weight, you may try to find the random weight. And this random weight can be a sequence of 0 and 1 coming from the characteristic function of the set A of positive measure and a transformation T, which is measure preserving. Is it a new idea? Not really, because this idea where you have to take averages like that, so if you take the simple case, 1 over n, the sum from n equals 0 to n minus 1, the characteristic function of A, T and X, times no G, I take this just for the case k equal 1, GSN composes that. This type of things, find phenomena where you have no a sequence of 0 and 1, when do you get 1? You get 1 when T and X belongs to A. So if you look at the set A here, you are in your capital set X. This is your set A. You have your map, which starts from X here. And then you go back. T, my X may be here. T2 square here being here. Then you go here after T and X. Then you may stay here for a while, but you get out. And then you come back here again, no? Each time that you hit your set A, you are going to get a sequence of 0 and 1. So TNX is equal to 1 if TNX belongs to A, and equal to 0 if not. So basically, you are looking at the averages. But once you fix your X, this is the same weight that you are going to apply to all the dynamical systems that are coming on the right-hand side. So what does this mean is that, in fact, what you are doing is you are averaging along the sequence of return times to a set A. And so this is called no return times phenomena. This concept is not new. The first one to have to think of thinking about getting some kind of weighted averages where the weight is given randomly by the return times to a set is, as far as I could go back, to Antoine Brunel. In his PhD thesis, I think, is 1966. Then in 1969, he published a paper with Michael Keane where this idea is amplified. So here's what I was explaining to explain. You have a sequence of 0 and 1. We look at the subsequence nj, x, of a multiple recurrent averages, where nj is the jth return times to the set A, of tnx to A. So the previous question that I was raising here is that would be equivalent asking whether this has a limit which is strictly positive. OK? Now, some work has been done on that, so try to know what was done before. I've been obsessed recently with the study of return times, as I said, by Brunel in his thesis in 1966. That's also another answer to our question, Stefano, a little bit. You get the integral of that. That's what I was trying to explain with case k equals 3, right? OK, so basically the question is put some weight here and try to understand or try to see this limit exists in weakly, in norm, almost everywhere. Okay. So let's look at what was done in this case. If you just take the weight equal to 1, the study of these averages has been studied extensively for norm convergence. So who are those? The case SI equal to the power of S. This was done by Austin and Crane 2005. Okay? The case SI commuting was done by Terry Tao in 2008. The case where SI generates a nilpotent group, which is the most general case that you can think of, was done by Miguel Walsh. Miguel did it when he was a graduate student. So that's why I'm bringing this issue here, saying that maybe a graduate student can solve the Erdős-Terön conjecture. Am I wrong? So it's doable, okay? And really, what was impressive by what Miguel did was the fact that he used basically a very simple tool. It's a Hahn-Banach theorem, basically. His argument is Hahn-Banach. But well, no, the elders, more senior, were looking at more powerful tools and all that. He came up with a simple idea and got the most general case possible. If you try to get something a little bit more like nilpotent group, a solvable group, then there are contra-examples to these averages. Okay, for the pointwise convergence, well, the pointwise convergence for that is a problem I've been studying for quite some time, and sometimes I think I have it, sometimes I don't. So it happens, okay? But I keep working on it and making attempts to try to get in general. But the general which is known and be correct and was done only for the case K equal 2 by Jean Bourguin in 1990. Okay. So now let's see what we did, okay? So first we have to define a more general process. What is a process? So you take a non-negative integers, you get xn, which is a bounded and measurable function on some probability measure space. That's what I call a process. Then one can we say that this process is going to generate a good universal weight for a process which could be pointwise in norm if for every probability measure preserving system space for which the process is defined, these averages converge p, for p almost every omega. So p almost omega or convergence also in L2 p norm. Okay? So Brunel and Kind remind you the result that Brunel and Kind had. When you write it this way, you get the Cartesian function of ATNX and then your GSN of Y. If you apply Y to this, you are looking for the pointwise convergence with respect to Y. Of this single set of full measure where you take this little x. Clear here? Any questions so far? No? Okay, so the general case for T, just the measure preserving transformations, S measure preserving transformations, was done by Bourguin also in 1989, 1990. And the proof that he had was 50 pages long. In fact, at this time, it's around 80, several mathematicians were asking questions to Jean Bourguin, and he sent regularly, every month, a solution, 50 pages long papers. Okay? So this one was not an exception, it was also a 50 pages long paper. But was never published at the end because by the time he was through to submit to publish it, he got another proof with Fürstenberg, Katzenson, Bourguin, Fürstenberg, Katzenson, and Ornstein. Okay, so now let's see. For the return times, and I'm giving all this because I'm giving the slide to presentation science to Stefano. So if some of you are interested, I can get a copy of this slide with all the data. At the end of the slide, there's also the list of references. So you see exactly what was done and who was. So that's where you get this number 24, 1, and all that. So you have all the references there in case some of you are interested. So I said that Ossenkrauz proved that you have, so Rudolph did the multiple return times. Now, I was interested in already 1990, 95, after meeting Fürstenberg, he brought all these questions to my attention. I was getting a result on the multiple recurrence pointwise. And I start mixing results in multiple recurrence and multi-term return times in 2000. Okay, so it was even before the Ossenkrauz Ziegler factor and everything like that. So Ossenkrauz showed that it's good universal weight for the norm convergence in 2009. This is exactly what they did here. So instead of having here G of Sn, what they did is they put here in front of that 1 over n, the sum from n equals 0 to capital N minus 1, the Cauchy function of A, T, and X. And then let's take the case G, S, and 1, S, G1, and G2, S, 2n, and to be nice, and have a prime number here. That's right. And they show that there exists a set of full measures where, no, you can extract from that a set capital XA where these averages are going to converge for basically, you know, all dynamical systems and all functions G1, G2, G3, which are bounded. Okay? So this is a generalization of the result that they had already when here this weight was replaced by 1. So as you can see, this fits with this kind of universal weight that I mentioned at the beginning. When you have a process in this case is, this is a process, xn, and this is your weight, which is cn here. And here's your process. And then you're averaging, no? That's what you are doing. Okay, so it's a norm convergence result. Right? So if you take G1, G2, G3 equal to the characteristic function of the set E, that's what you get basically for the case, no, replacing 3 by K. Okay, can we generalize that? Well, if instead of returning to the set A along the powers of T, you could try to have a weight of a form CA1 TNX. I'm just looking at the simplest case. CA2 T2NX. That's the kind of weight CN that I'm interested in. Okay? So let me get that. So we know that this kind of weight, the average is just of this weight converges by Borghen double recurrence theorem. And in 2001, my PhD student, David Denken, provided what he called a Wiener-Winter result for that. So I'm not going to explain too much because I don't have too much time what a Wiener-Winter result is, but there is a generalization of this result where you replace here, you multiply this by you take the Cauchy function of A, T, and X, the Cauchy function of A1, A2, T2, and X, and you plus here a weight E to the 2 pi I and T. So it's not too difficult to show that for every X, for every T, this is going to converge. But the key is to find a set which is independent of T, a full measure, which is converged for every T. Now, why is it interesting? It's because if you have something like that, then it's just a simple application of a spectral theorem will give you automatically the convergent norm of these averages. These two things are equivalent. So if you have a convergence of a single null set for all t, this is equivalent to the norm convergence for this. So the first step was to try to get a Wiener-Winter result for the double recurrence. It was done by David Denken in 2000 without knowing at the time the existence of the Ostenkraft factors. So now in 2014, I'm going to start now quoting now the result that I have with Rio. All of them are been referee, all of them now accepted to papers, no? ETDS, Journal d'Analyse Mathématique. About 4 papers on this subject. Okay? So, is the pointer working well? Because I keep. Okay, yeah. Okay. So, 2014, this is the result that we had. The first result was to, as I said, get this win of inter result. This win of inter result, which is to say, which is a generalization of Bourguin double recurrence, that many people were tend to get because they thought that the Bourguin result is so difficult in terms of its proof that they thought that it was a very difficult result to get. Actually, it's about 15 pages long to get this result. It's not that complicated if you use a nice approach. So we get this one, where ZK is a K, Ost and Krauss-Ziegler factor. I don't have time to explain what the Ost and Krauss-Ziegler factor is, but what you have here is that the result works. The win of inter result works for the double recurrence. So this is already an extension of Bourguin result itself, which was not considered as a trivial result. Okay? They said, this is already to show that, no, this kind of weight are good universal for the norm convergence for any dynamical system. Now, a little bit about this because of the fact that I'm sending the slide for those who want to get a very quick glance at what was done. So I'm not going to talk about an L-step Nipotent Lie group, but they are all at the basis and behind the scene in terms of the proof there. And what is a co-compact, what is a Neel system, I'll just cruise on that, okay? Unless there is a question on it. No? Okay. Okay, so now, in 2014, after hearing this result here that we had, this one, that one's converged for every T, Benji Weiss asked, okay, can we replace now this weight e to the 2 pi nt, replace this e to the 2 pi nt by just what is called a Neel sequence. A Neel sequence is a more general form of this kind of weight. And he asked whether or not we could replace e to the pi nt by these Neel sequences. Okay, so give you a definition of what a Neel system is. A bit complicated, but just for you to get an idea, a general idea of what is there. So this is what is called a one-step Neel sequence. And in fact, if you put here instead of a polynomial degree one, which is nt, you take a polynomial which is with integer values. This is also e to the pnt, is also an L-step Neel sequence. Now, the interest in Neel sequence comes from number theory. This is something that you see in the work of Green and Tao many times, several papers on Neel sequences. Also here, I'm not going to get into the detail of that. Okay, now, I was able to answer the question by Benji Weiss positively, and by showing that we could replace and generalize this by putting here, instead of e to the 2 pi nt, use here bn, where bn is a Neel sequence. So this work was obtained almost at the same time by Pavel. In fact, Pavel Zorin-Kranich also obtained this result. I think that we both posted the result on archive more or less within 2 days, each other. So, done that. Okay, so we have that. Then now, we start getting greedy. So instead of having a win of inter, then let's try to have something a bit more general and putting here this instead of just G composed VSN, can we just get this type of process in front of that? And if you get this process, this means that you'll be at the same time a generalization of Bourguin and a generalization of the Ost-and-Krauss result. We are able to get that too. So let me just give you that. That's right. We've got also some data on what was done before, to be sure. So 1990, you have Lezing, Franzi-Kinakis, just for the polynomial case. You have also Eisner and Krauss. Krauss is a student of Tao. Tania Eisner, you have also Pavel. So we prove this result here. I'm going to just click here. Again, in 2015. Which is at the same time contains Bourguin result and also the Ost-and-Krauss result, which is to show that this CN are a good weight for the Fürstenberg averages.
Okay.
So that was one. And let's be more greedy. Let's try to see if also, if you take the commuting case, you can still have the same result. The answer is yes. Okay. So that's what I was saying here. Yes? Right? So we can at the same time get the Bogen result and tau result at once by the following. I'm going just to say that here. Again, 2015. Well, as you can see, instead of having here the power of S to the IN, we get SI to the N, where SI are commuting transformations. So if you take F1 and F2 to be just a function identically equal to 1, you get the Fürstenberg averages, but for commuting transformations. In this case, no, we get a result which at the same time generalized Bogen and also the tau result, which was considered for many as out of reach for at least a couple of years. Okay, so unless you ask some questions, no. Any questions there? Because this is quite technical. I don't want to be more boring, but I need to. I give you too many technical details, just for you to get the essence of the result and the references. Anyone interested in getting more details? I don't think so. We are close to lunchtime, and I understand. So let's close on that back quickly and enjoy the lunch. Okay, so, okay. Just give you a couple of ideas how to do it. So. You get the Wiener-Wintner on one hand, and the second one is to look factors, the appropriate factors. What are the appropriate factors of Y? That's the basic idea. Decompose that into two steps. One step is to look at the Wiener-Wintner, the second one is to look at the appropriate factors of Y. Okay? Then, if you take the orthogonal complement of a factor, you get the norm convergence to zero. If they all belong to the factor, then you apply a Lipmann convergence theorem. So this is a simple path, but there are some technical problems along the way because you have to have null sets which are just independent of the other processes, and that's what makes the things technically difficult. Okay, so now, next steps. Next step is to try to get a Nigel offshore here instead of having transformation which are commuting. Here, what we would do is to take transformation with formally photon group, which is the most general form of that. That, we don't have that yet. So that's the next step that we are trying to look for. Okay? Now, go back to the problem about understanding both the structure of set of arithmetic progressions is looking at something like this. Is it strictly positive? Is the limit strictly positive when it exists? Of course, we must have ergodicity in some ways to be sure that the limit is strictly positive for just the weight, but this question is still open. Does the limit is also strictly positive? Okay? And is there a lower bound? Is it sceneticity? So all this kind of stuff which have application to number theory. So I have a result which is more general than those who create the existence of set of positive upper density generating arithmetic progressions. But so far we are looking at the applications to number theory. Clearly there are already something that you can understand about the structure of subset of natural numbers generating or containing a lot of arithmetic progressions, but no, this is a much sharper result. Okay, here are the references. I'll give you references there. All of them are there. Submitted, Rio, Brunel, David Duncan, Fürstenberg, Lezigne, Miguel Walsh, Pavel Zorin, and I think before that also Terry Tao and Rudolph. Okay. After that, thanks for your invitations. Okay. Thank you.